Thanks, and thanks for having me here to talk today a little bit about hacked by crypto and what does that mean. So in my slides today, we're going to be talking a lot about some of the standards development, what those are going to mean for operational security and for security defense in depth holistically. You'll notice, though, that in my slides, I've tried to be overly verbose and put in a lot of the content that I will normally say. I will add to the content on the slides, but I did this on purpose so that when you go back to your organizations and you're briefing your people inside your organization, either it's information security, it's operational security, it's your GSO office, that you'll be able to have my slides, you'll have the content on them, you'll be able to have the talking points that you need to remember, and then obviously then you can, you know, in grandes and talk a little bit, you know, beyond that, but you'll at least have all of the key points. I've included a bunch of graphics and diagrams in here that you can use as well. All of the slides will be made available on the RSA website, so, you know, I know people like to take pictures during the presentation of the slides, but you can actually download the slides from the conference. So on our agenda today, we're gonna talk about the winds of change. What's going on with protocols? What does that mean? What's happening with TLS 1.3, QUIC, all the changes to DNS, and how is that going to impact us? Do a really quick wake-up call, talk a little bit about what now, where do we go from here, and then try to summarize and bring everything back together and talk a little bit about the conclusion of kind of the state of cybersecurity and cyber defense. So there's a lot of protocols and a lot of standards and a lot of SDOs or standards bodies that work on these technologies that we all rely on and that we use in our daily life. I've put a little collage here together to kind of show you how some of them are intertwined and interlinked one with another. Like I said, we're going to talk about TLS 1.3. We're going to talk about QUIC. We're going to talk about all the changes to DNS. There will be a couple slides that are primer slides, which most all of you should fully understand and have, you know, be very well versed in. But once again, they're in the slide deck so that when you go back to your organizations and you're briefing your internal people, you will have that content. I'm also going to try and be very fair to all of these protocols and all of these changes to make sure that we first talk about what are the benefits. Why? Because it's not all doom and gloom, right? What were these things designed to do, and why are they neat and interesting? And then talk about the potential complications. So TLS 1.3 is now an RFC standard. It's come out of the IETF. It was in August 2018. So the big things that TLS 1.3 gives us is it removes a lot of the broken crypto that existed in 1.2. As you know, there's entire appendixes in RFC land that lists all of the known ciphers that you should not use. So all of those have been removed. All of the very complicated configuration options that existed with 1.2 and earlier, those have all been removed. The idea and the theory is that if it's easier for people to configure and set up, it's gonna be less error prone, and organizations should be able to do it more efficiently and better. And then one of the other pieces that is critical is that TLS 1.3 is restricted to PFS, which is perfect forward secrecy, meaning that if you compromise any one part of the session, you won't be able to use that key material or that information to compromise future sessions. Another thing that the working group in the IETF worked on, and I was part of that group, is to improve the performance. As we know with mobile networks, the latency can be pretty extensive. You can add 100 to 300 milliseconds of latency on every round trip with a mobile device. And so one thing that was done in TLS 1.3 was to reduce the amount of round trips necessary to get the handshake up and going and get the session actually started. So it used to be 2 in TLS 1.2. It's now been reduced to 1 in TLS 1.3, and there is even an option for 0 round trip recovery or to reestablish an existing or former connection. So I did some diagrams here to help you and help people that you talk with understand this handshake. On the left-hand side, you'll see the TLS 1.2 handshake where you do your client hello, and then the server responds, and you pass the keying material, and then you go on down and you start your HTTP response. You know, all this should be pretty, everyone should understand how this works. TLS 1.3, when the client starts its hello message, it actually gives its Diffie-Hellman key material at that time. So when the server responds, it already has everything that it needs to form an encrypted tunnel. One of the downsides of doing this, as you can see right here, you know, that the key material comes back from the server, that server session is all encrypted. One of the potential complications is that the server certificate is now encrypted. So historically, when you would do any type of network-based analysis and network-based monitoring, any type of inspection, you would rely on this server certificate to help you understand where a client was going, what a client was doing. And now that certificate, as it comes back in TLS 1.3, as I've highlighted in yellow, I apologize if people are colorblind, but it's that part is encrypted. And so you no longer see the server certificate as it traverses the wire. So policy-based bypass, which is very common in network-based inspection, is going to be really difficult going forward. The only thing that you're going to have is the SNI value to attempt to do some verification. You can no longer verify that the SNI that you were given from the client actually matches up to a server, to the specific server certificate. You may have a fronting server that accepts a bogus SNI and then uses that SNI to translate it on the backside to go to some other site. So from a policy-based inspection, this is going to be problematic. And when you start dealing with regulatory compliance and you're having to monitor certain types of sessions but not others, like you don't want to look at banking or healthcare sites, but you need to be able to make sure you're not data exfiltrating data to rogue sites or things like that. So that's going to become harder. Obviously, the whole phishing, stage one, stage two malware delivery, that's going to become increasingly more difficult. On the categorization side, you're going to be limited to that SNI value. And who knows if that SNI value is going to be correct, if it's going to be something that you can actually use. And then the last thing that we've heard a lot of people complain about is there is no more static RSA support. So what does this mean? So a lot of times organizations, especially banks and sometimes healthcare, government spaces, industrial control, critical infrastructure, they out on the servers that the traffic is terminating on, and so they have the RSA private key for that server, and they can archive that in a cold storage. And when they need to go back and do an investigation, after the fact or retrospectively, they can use that key material to go in and decrypt the session and figure out what happened. Since there is no more static RSA support in TLS 1.3, this whole idea of in the data center, offline decrypt is now impossible. So as I mentioned, we're gonna talk a little bit about DNS. Everyone should understand this really well, but as a quick recap, you have a client resolver, which is our client, our stub resolver in DNS parlance. And then you make a request to your internal DNS server. In the DNS parlance, that is referred to as a caching recursive resolver. And so those terms are kind of important when you read through the DNS specs, making sure you understand it. Then the client, obviously, it's UDP 53, goes out, hits your root zone, then hits your TLD, and then hits your example.com, and you get a response. So everyone, I believe, understands that really well. So along came DNSSEC a while ago. And what it does is it provides, assurance between that trusted caching resolver or our internal DNS server and the rest of the DNS world. It makes sure that the information that we get back is both correct and current. It does not do anything to hide the data. It doesn't, encrypt the data. All of that information is still in plain text, and you could monitor that DNS traffic. Basically, what it does is it just signs that DNS response so that you know that it's legitimate. There's also the element of the last mile that goes from your internal DNS server or that trusted caching resolving server to the end client. That's the last mile. That is not signed, that is not encrypted, but there is an AD bit that is put on the header that the client just has to trust. Now, some endpoints are starting to add support for DNSSEC in the client themselves. There are tools that are now available that you can add this to your Windows system, your Mac, your Linux box. There's even talk about adding some of this natively into the browser. And so we're going to talk a little bit about this in a minute to understand kind of what's the complications of this. So, and then the last point you need to be mindful of, depending on how you've designed your infrastructure, that TCP is probably going to be used for a lot of this DNSSEC traffic simply due to size, because it's going to be over the boundary of the UDP packet, and so it's going to have to be in a TCP packet. So I did another diagram for you, so you can make sure that you understand this. Obviously, the query starts at the top, and you start from the furthest out, and you work your way into the example.com server. But when you're doing DNSSEC, you actually go the reverse. So after you get the response, you get to the example.com to get the DNS key, and then you turn around and you verify that at .com. You then verify that at the .root, and then you verify that response with your trust anchor that's on your local machine that you have configured. And then as you can see at the bottom, the response goes back to the client or the endpoint with that 80-bit value set to 1. So potential complications. So by itself, DNSSEC is quite frankly a good thing. It helps ensure a lot of things. It helps make sure that, you know, threat actors and intrusion sets are not injecting bad data into DNS and redirecting us. But as DNSSEC moves into the endpoint, your ability for doing any types of content filtering or monitoring of site traffic, doing any type of black holing or tar pitting of DNS traffic is going to become a challenge for you. So you need to be mindful of that. A little bit later, I'll probably talk a little bit about where you'd probably want to think about locating your DNS servers going forward. But just in case I forget, as you look to re-architect your networks over time, it would probably be a good idea to start locating your DNS servers on the WAN side of your proxy or the WAN side of your firewall or whatever's doing your network-based inspection. And I'll hopefully have time to get into that in a little bit, but you're going to need that in order to build up a trust, an island of trust, as we call it in DNS land, so that you can rewrite TLSA records on the fly and be able to do this inspection. Another element of DNS which can be interesting is DANE. Once again, this one isn't new, so you should have some familiarity with it. There's three things that DANE provides, and for the sake of this discussion, we're only really interested in the third. You know, it has the ability to do email encryption, great. Has the ability to verify the certificate you get over HTTPS, great. But what we're most interested in is the fact that a provider or a company can actually publish their cert in DNS natively. So this gets rid of all of the need for certificate authorities. So you don't have to have that whole certificate chain and all of the problems that come with that. It does require DNSSEC to be effective. Self-signed certs would work just fine. There would be no problems like you have today. And one of the big benefits is there's no change needed for your web server, your website, the TLS server, anything that's using this. You can just basically add the TLSA record to DNS, and assuming your clients support it and know how to look it up and work with it, that's all you need to do. From the complication side, though, is DANE with DNSSEC could allow organizations and content providers to do certificate pinning, which would then basically prevent or give a bad experience to your end users when you're doing any type of network-based inspection. It would basically invalidate that local trust root CA that you install when you deploy it out to all of your clients as part of its build. And this could greatly increase your problems with regulatory compliance. So keep that in mind, make sure you understand what that means, make sure you're talking to your GSO office, your risk office, and so you understand what kind of aspects you need to be mindful of. In my opinion, it also has the potential of breeding bad behavior. As individuals begin to see more certificate warnings on sites, and they become more common, users are just going to become more comfortable with just bypassing certificate warnings, okay? Something that is new is DNS over HTTPS. So this is a new standard. It is an RFC. It has come out of the IETF recently. And it no longer uses UDP or TCP, you know, the port 53 based TCP. All of the traffic for the DNS goes over HTTPS. So it's all encrypted. It's part of that encrypted tunnel. There's no more visibility from the network. And more importantly, all of the resolution can be done inside the browser itself. So Firefox today supports this, and they have named their trusted recursive resolving provider as Cloudflare. So if your users are using Firefox in your network, and you have not modified or changed this in the configuration, then your DNS queries are going out to Cloudflare. Okay? So the systems that deploy DOE will not be using your local DNS servers that you push out through DHCP to the client. They'll be using stuff, namely, inside the browser and how it's configured. So you need to be very mindful of that. DNSSEC is still required. Another variant of this is DOT, which is DNS over TCP, or over TLS, sorry. So I gave another little diagram. So once again, you can see how the trusted caching recursive resolver is now outside of your enterprise. It's outside, you know, somewhere on the internet, like Cloudflare or some other provider. You make this DOE request out to it, and then it does the normal DNS traffic and then turns around and responds directly to the client, all inside of a encrypted stream. So your network protection and network inspection devices will not be able to monitor DNS traffic. You're going to have less retrospective analysis capabilities when you're looking at an incident and you're trying to do investigations on threat actor behavior or an intrusion set, trying to understand what it was they did, what did the client query for. You're going to be pretty much blind. I've got a couple other things here that you can go through and look at offline, but it will increase some various difficulties. You just fundamentally, you need to be careful that you configure your clients and that you understand what all of those configuration options are going to be for all of the various browsers and various software that runs on your clients. Going forward, your organization may need to actually look at implementing their own DOE server and then being able to point to it. I haven't yet seen bind support DOE, but I'm guessing that will be coming. So once again, this also leads to the idea of starting to locate your DNS servers on the WAN side of your proxy or the WAN side of your firewall, whatever is doing your network-based inspection. The scary thing, in my opinion, is a piece of work that is currently under development that you should be mindful of, and it's called opportunistic DOE. And what this does is it allows a website to server push resolution to DNS entries before the client even asks about them. So the server can say, hey, I think you're going to be asking for these various sites, whether they are ad network sites or other content that it believes that you're going to be going to. And it can just push the DNS resolutions to your client over DOE. And so the client doesn't even have to ask. So once again, this is going to become very interesting when you want to remove certain types of traffic from your network, especially malicious traffic or phishing sites or stage one, stage two malware delivery, known data exfiltration sites, because the client will just have those addresses right in its memory. When I look at this as, you know, if I was a threat actor and if I was writing malicious code, I think this is a brilliant thing. Because now, when I compromise a website and I do a waterhole attack and everyone comes and visits my website, I can just push all of the DNS responses to all the sites I want you to go to, and it's just going to magically show up in the browser cache. Recap, server SNI, the server name aspect, this is to help route traffic to the correct server if one IP address is hosting more than one encrypted website, more than one HTTPS session. Okay, this has been around for a while. SNI does expose where the client is going, even in TLS 1.3. But as I mentioned earlier in the deck, you know, the client could forge that, they could fake that, they could put other information in that field. But it does potentially expose where the client is going. What becomes interesting is there's some work also being done in the ITF. There's this desire to encrypt everything and hide every piece of traffic so that you can't identify where anyone ever is going. And they're working on some encrypted SNI. Purpose is to fundamentally hide where a client is going, to prevent all visibility and knowledge from the network standpoint of what a client is doing, whether that's legitimate behavior or whether that's threat actor or malicious behavior. This may help privacy in some situations, but as far as I can tell, this is just going to hurt operational security everywhere. Repressive nations may find ways, depending on how this is implemented, just to either sidestep it or block it completely outright. It only works with TLS 1.3 and because your otherwise your server certificate is in the plain text and you would just use that. And it really does require DOE or DOT because otherwise you could just monitor the DNS queries and you could find out where the client is going. I did build a diagram. There's a lot of pieces to this. I'm not going to walk through it completely here, but I wanted to make sure that you had something that you could reference and you could look at afterwards. So on the far right, you're going to have key material that is going to be created. You have your domain, SNI, public key material. It's not an RSA key, it's Diffie-Hellman stuff. And then you have the private portion of that. You're going to publish the public information into DNS, into an underscore ESNI text record. And then the client will be able to go out to DNS when it does its resolution. It'll be able to get that key material. It'll be able to combine it with its own ephemeral private key and encrypt the SNI. And then when it sends it across, and so what I've done here on the right is I've shown you what a fronting server would look like a CDN, and then the back-end origin server and how those would actually have to share some key material in order for it to work. But in a nutshell, this is how encrypted SNI is going to play out, and it uses DNS to deliver this. So when you start thinking of encrypted DNS over DOE, and you start thinking of DNSSEC and pinning, certificate pinning through DANE, you begin to see that your abilities to look at the network is going to become increasingly more difficult. One of the last protocols that I'd like to talk a little bit about is QUIC. It's also in development at the IETF. It has been a proprietary protocol by Google for many years and is actively being used by Google. The thing that you need to be mindful of is this replaces TCP. So QUIC runs over UDP 443. All of the key exchange, all the key material is done with TLS 1.3. And it has very significant performance improvements and advantages over a traditional TCP, HTTP type session. So there was some head of line blocking problems in HTTP 2. And so this gets resolved because you have one single QUIC connection, and inside that you have various QUIC transports, and inside of each one of those, you're going to have an individual HTTP stream. So all of your HTTP traffic now goes over UDP. And last I was on your side of the fence, I remember vendors and firewall vendors always talking to me about how performant their firewall was, but it was based on TCP, and it's going to be really interesting to see what happens when all of this traffic goes over UDP. QUIC is also done in user space, so it's not a kernel module. You don't need to wait for routers and switches to get updated to support it. You don't need to wait for kernel operating system changes. You don't have to worry about, you know, all those things preventing this from taking off and being successful. This is coming, and it's coming quite fast. So once again, I did some diagrams to help kind of illustrate this. On the left, you have a traditional TCP TLS handshake. You know, you have your traditional SYN, SYNACK, ACK. You have your client hello and your server hello and your response. With QUIC, all of that TCP information and all the TLS information is all done at once. So by the time you get one round trip, you effectively have a complete connection up and going. So you're going to save a lot of round trip time. So for web applications, mobile apps, IoT kind of communications, this is very quick and very fast to set up. But there is no TCP state. There is no sequence numbers. There is no performance monitoring. There is no, you know, MTU path discovery, congestion analysis, all of those wonderful things that we for years have used to help identify and monitor the network and identify what's going on, all of that becomes opaque. I know as a network engineer, I would get asked frequently by the server administration group or an application owner why their payroll application or their HR application was not behaving correctly. And so they would want me to look at it from the network perspective and say, can you identify what's going on? And now in QUIC, it's pretty much going to be opaque. So once again, this is also, you know, it's done in user space. So this is very much a potential attack vector for threat actors. And then when you're doing load balancing on your servers, especially in a cloud type environment, as you know, NAT doesn't really work well with UDP. And so when a UDP timeout takes place, there's really not a great way for it to fail over and to understand that it's part of an existing session. And so there's gonna be a little bit of problems there as we go through this until the NAT systems and the devices that you use for load balancing either become smarter or they keep their timeouts open for a lot longer. Some nitty gritty details. You know, there's possible fragmentation issues, but I think the most important thing to be mindful of is if you're not currently blocking outbound UDP 443, then you're leaking data. You're completely blind to it. None of your devices, your monitoring tools, your firewalls are going to know what it is. It's just, you know, the term I would use internally is people are hemorrhaging because you have zero visibility into what's going on. So it's been in use by Google for years. Some of the analysis from various conference sites go to show that there is quite a substantial amount of traffic that is already quick. Well, they don't know it's quick. It's UDP 443, and like, who knows what it is. I also think that, you know, like any new protocol, especially things done in user space, you know, there's going to be a pretty interesting attack surface until implementations become hardened and we can have some level of assurance. There's also a potential for problems as it is user space. So you get an implementation in Chrome, you get a separate implementation in Firefox, you get a separate implementation in your iTunes, you know, music store. And what is that going to mean, and you know, what's going to happen deep down inside your OS. So something to be mindful of. So what's driving all of these changes? There's been some stigma or there's some dogma that exists currently throughout the standards bodies and through many circles that privacy is security. And you have to have full 100% privacy in order to have any type of security. And they're in talking with a lot of organizations and a lot of content providers and a lot of really big ones that you probably could name on one hand, they believe that nothing should be in between them and the user that they're talking to. One of them even mentioned that they're, you know, no, you shouldn't be removing any malware or malicious content from that stream. And no, you should not be removing our ads or our trackers or anything else that we might put into that stream. They want a guaranteed connection between their provider and the end user. So, Google publishes some great reports on the usage of encrypted web traffic from Chrome. And so over the past, you know, several years, we've seen a steady uptake on Google products, whether it be, you know, Chrome or whether it be Android. And so, you know, we should all celebrate. We should all pour ourselves a glass of champagne and realize that finally we are getting to a place where packets on the internet are encrypted, they are secure, and you know, everyone should be happy that we've made great progress. When we look at this from a threat actor behavior standpoint, and this is just one piece of data, and you know, the only data that I can show is a couple years old, but that's because it's internal data. But this trend does continue. So threat actors and intrusion sets are now using legitimate crypto and real certificates and using Let's Encrypt to get those certificates so that they're trusted by the browser and by the client. And the overall use by threat actors for phishing sites or stage one, stage two malware delivery or for data exfiltration is also going up. So the scary part is, you know, more than half of all of our web attacks are now encrypted as well. So what now? So we have endpoints everywhere. This is just the reality of life today. You have SCADA systems, hospitals, smart homes, IT, IoT, you know, critical infrastructure. There are endpoints literally everywhere. Not all endpoints can easily run security software. This is reality. It may not be available for all the real-time operating systems or all the various other types. It might not be available for certain embedded platforms, industrial control systems, you know, IoT devices, medical devices. It just may not be available. And even if it can, it may not actually be current. So as you know, with security software, in order for it to be effective, it really does need to be updated on a semi-regular basis. And if it's not updated, then the definitions, the heuristics, the signatures, whatever you're using, become out of date. And so we also need to accept the fact that not all endpoints see every update at the same time. So there's always going to be gaps in your coverage. In addition to security software, endpoints sometimes can't even be updated or patched. Imagine trying to patch 50-year-old hardware that has been soldered into critical infrastructure. Okay. What about MRI machines and IoT devices? What about these new cost-optimized IoT products that aren't designed for any type of security software? They're not designed to ever be updated or patched, but they are cost-optimized for the market. Playing whack-a-mole is not sustainable. We should all know this by now, but you cannot patch your way into security. An additional set of challenges for endpoint is we know that threat actors can target and evade endpoint security software depending on where they target the endpoint. How low in the stack are they attacking? Are they attacking microcode, firmware code? Are they attacking the CPU itself? Do they have a zero-day bypass? Is there privilege escalation, vulnerabilities that they're aware of? And we know that crime syndicates and threat actors, that they stockpile these things, right? They collect them, they do a lot of research, and then they slowly use these and they make use of them going forward, nation states as well. Okay, so when we look at this from the other side, you know, for the individuals that think that all network protection should go away and we should only ever have endpoints and content providers, the benefit of the network is it sees all traffic. For 24 years as a network engineer, I would tell my companies that I worked for that an operating system, an application, software, the client, the endpoint, it can always be made to lie. But at the end of the day, the network doesn't. It never lies. The traffic always has to flow over the network. And the only place that you're guaranteed to ever see it is on the network. So if you do inspection on the device, if you've ever done incident response on an endpoint, you cannot guarantee that what you're seeing is actually legitimate. You know, there's a lot of things that we try to do, and there's a lot of things that we really work hard at in incident response and endpoint forensics to help us, but it can always be made to lie, but the network never does. The network can also be the bodyguard for endpoints that can't protect themselves. It allows this rapid prevention, mitigation, remediation that can take place long before an operating system manufacturer or an application developer has time to patch, or that you have time to deploy that patch. It often, gets cited as something that helps with regulatory compliance. And, in the ICS world with operational technology, it is critical that you have this network-based security in order to defend, the Modbus systems and the SCADA systems. And the terrifying thing is as, SCADA systems move over to IP from Modbus and these become more readily exploitable by threat actors, it's going to be very interesting. So a couple conclusions to think about. And I don't know how I'm doing on time, but does more encryption increase security? If we end up encrypting everything and guaranteeing 100% privacy for an individual inside your network, as they communicate to something on the outside world, does this make us more secure? Is every endpoint in your network always secure, always patched, and is it invincible to every conceivable attack from every threat actor and intrusion set that exists? Can you always trust every website to never host malicious content and never be compromised? Can you guarantee that Aurora will never happen again? Can you trust every insider? every individual in your organization? Can you guarantee that every insider and every endpoint is never going to leak any of your intellectual property outside? So when you're thinking about this and you're working with your organizations, some questions to ponder is, how are these new technologies going to impact your ability to defend your users, your data, your systems, your network? What is this going to mean for you in an operational standpoint? What is it going to mean for you when a threat actor, and I've done some proof of concept code on this, which no, I'm not gonna ever release, and no, I'm not gonna make available, to show how easy it is to exploit systems based upon a combination of these technologies. But what are you gonna do when threat actors start doing this? Okay, what are you gonna do when all of your network traffic goes dark? How are you gonna maintain your regulatory compliance? What about your intellectual property? What about data exfiltration? In my opinion, we need a balance. You know, there needs to be a balance between privacy and security. I'm all for privacy, and I think privacy is a really important thing. But there also comes a point when, you know, organizations need to protect themselves and their users in their organizations. And there's also some people, like my mom, that I would love to be able to subscribe to one of those people downstairs and all those little booths that have all these great, you know, cloud products that do stuff. I would like to be able to go onto her computer and sign her up for everything and just say, please protect my mom. No, I really don't care if her session isn't 100% guaranteed private between her and name your CDN or, you know, content provider. I'm much more concerned that someone isn't going to do elder abuse or some sort of scam or some sort of compromise of my mom. I mean, I finally got her a Mac because I got tired of her calling me every day to ask how to get Word to open up. But you know, it's terrifying, right? So we want to have that balance. So what, in my opinion, what I think, you know, you here today, maybe what you could do to apply what you've learned is to connect with your security team. Make sure, you know, you understand and they understand, you know, what type of security is going to be lost in these type of situations. What type of content-aware network devices are going to instantly become non-effective. You may also want to ask them, how much traffic do we currently have on UDP port 443? And then ask them if they know what it is. You might want to talk to your network operations team. See if they understand what it means when QUIC replaces TCP. What is that going to do to the firewalls and your proxies and your other devices? What about Dane replacing Web PKI? What about installing your root, you know, trusted store onto the endpoint? What happens when that's no longer effective? And then, my opinion, the opportunistic encrypted DOE replacing DNS. And then in your 3-month time frame, you know, what kind of critical controls are going to be impacted that require network-based protection? Have you identified the gaps between what you can do on an endpoint and what you need to be able to do at the network, and for endpoints that don't have the ability to run security software or that you cannot guarantee they're going to be updated and patched in a reasonable amount of time? You may want to consider, you know, engaging in the various standards bodies and voicing your use cases. Whether, you know, in this case, a lot of these are coming out of the IETF, but you may want to consider doing that and making sure that your vendors that you trust and that you buy from, make sure they're aware of this and make sure that they are there trying to vouch for your behavior or for your use cases. Now, I will note, I've worked in standards for a long time, whether it's the IEEE or ITU or IETF or OASIS and others, and there's a tactic that a lot of people in standards use. You're gonna come up and you're gonna say, hey, I have this use case. And they're gonna instantly respond with pretty aggressive, pretty kind of hostile type communication because they have precedent that says if they combat you pretty aggressively, then you're just going to be quiet and go away. You don't have sticking power. And what you, if you want to have positive change, you need to get a bunch of people and you need to always be the squeaky wheel and you need to never go away. And I know I've done this in some standards bodies where, you know, after about 1,000 emails over about a 9-month period, I finally got people to listen. Within 6 months, you know, you really should, in your security playbooks and with your Office of General Counsel and your risk department, you should have a plan for your security controls and what is going to need to change, what is going to take place, what kind of problems you foresee, and what is going to be your strategy. You know, some of these technologies, they are coming fast. And this isn't like, well, we might see these in 10 years or 15 years. Some of them you're going to be seeing today. And so even asking your operational department, your network team, your security team, how much UDP 443 quick traffic do you have in your network today? Thank you, and thanks for coming to my talk. Oh, and I need to ask, if you like the talk, please fill out the survey because it really helps getting future talks approved. And so please do that. So,
one question on TLS inspection.
Yes.
This is very popular and we've been doing it for a while, but with TLS 1.3, this seems to be a difficult task because of the ESNI and the server certificate getting encrypted. Is this going to be a problem for TLS inspection with the advent of TLS 1.3? What is your opinion on that?
I am going to be really careful to not do any type of vendor, and I think you've been able to tell that I've never talked about vendor stuff. So I know from my company standpoint, we have solutions to this. But what I am concerned with is there's a lot of product that all of you rely on that is going to have some difficulty here. And it is very concerning because you're going to be forced into doing various strategies to try and help identify what traffic you should inspect versus inspecting everything. And you may end up saying that the cost or the risk of not doing the inspection is far greater than potentially inspecting some traffic that you shouldn't look at, like a banking transaction or a healthcare record or something like that. So there's a lot of uncertainty here with how vendors are going to do it. And I've tried really hard to make sure that I don't talk about anything from my day job. So just trying to make sure that I keep a nice clean cut there. So, but I do see it as a potential problem. You know, server certificate is used to help do policy-based inspection. You know, the SNI is used to help with that. And if both of these become dark, then you're going to need to put your DNS, as I mentioned early on, probably outside of your firewall or your proxy or whatever's doing your network-based inspection so that you can hopefully do some work with your vendors, whoever you use, maybe do some TLSA rewrites on the fly, terminating the session there and doing some inspection and trying to do various things. So, but definitely reach out to your vendors.
I just got one more question. You talked about, you know, let's encrypt. So what we do is we remove all the routes that are not acceptable to us. So if the browser brings a let's encrypt route, we remove it. So we're not going to entertain any encrypted traffic that is encrypted with the certificate derived off of let's encrypt.
Right.
But we're also seeing some vendors are proposing to use self-signed certificates because the cost of maintaining the PKI is huge. The conventional philosophy is that you don't use self-signed certificates. PKI is based on that.
Right.
What is your thoughts or opinions on self-signed certificates?
Well, depending on which organization you talk to, some say that certificate authorities provide great value. Some say that they're just very expensive. Some organizations like Google believe that a lot of certificates that are signed by certificate authorities aren't actually verified enough, and so they don't want to trust them. Self-signed certificates, if it's in your DNS infrastructure and that DNS record is signed, you know, effectively by you and by the organization above you and by the TLD and by root, there's a great level of assurance that self-signed certificate is legit. The way the market pans out, you know, that's not for me to speculate on. What I try to do is make sure that you understand where things are going, what things you need to be mindful of, and hopefully have a discussion, you know, with you. So any other questions? Thank you for coming today.